Hello everybody, this is Fernando for the latest Mysteries and Disappearances video. My apologies for the delay in these videos. I had to take just a small business trip, which kind of knocked me out for a couple of days. But now that I'm back, I'm able to work on some more of your videos. This one is based on one of your newer suggestions, and it has to do with an entry that even after 50-something years still pretty much remains unsolved. In fact, I think it's coming up on its anniversary, essentially, of its 50th year. So, lots of good interesting information to share. It has to do with yet another disappearance also in Australia, and it has to do with this. You're looking at him now. It's the disappearance of a very prominent gentleman there in Australia who went by the name of Harold Holt. So, let's go ahead. Let's talk about all the interesting information associated with this disappearance, including some of the theories. Three of them, in fact, having to do with why he disappeared. So first off, who was Harold Holt? Well, he was someone there that was a prominent member in Australia, both as a politician and then also became their prime minister back in 66 to 67. So he was definitely someone there that people knew. They knew him by name. He was one of those, I guess in the U.S. you can call him almost select men, the kind of people that have a good amount of prominence within the community, not necessarily like House household name type stuff, but within that local area, he's the kind of guy that people would point to and they would be, oh yeah, absolutely, you know, I know that guy. He was able to work on this or on that. He also went to various schools in his younger age, Queen's College, then University of Melbourne. He also got a law degree too, a Bachelor of Laws, and he was able to serve several years there too. So pretty much from his young life up to his later career, he was almost like going from a stepping stone advancing on things. Eventually he entered into politics, and then yes, eventually he became their prime minister there too. So I'm sure there's a lot more good information to share about his life and about the prominence that he had there, but in this case, this video, it's going to be mainly about his disappearance. So let's go ahead and let's talk about that. In fact, you have to go back to December 17th, 1967 to be exact. So again, coming up pretty much on almost 50 years of this disappearance. On that fateful day, there he was in a small group. He was there with a woman who went by the name of Marjorie Gillespie. She was actually rumored to be his lover, like his rumored, I guess, mistress or lover, something along those lines. She was there also with her daughter, the daughter's boyfriend, and then also a family friend. So it was a small group of people, and they all went to a place called Cheviot Beach, which you're looking at now. The reason they went here is because this guy, Harold Holt, was a huge swimming fan. Like, he was someone that swimmed throughout most of his life. I've heard about those people, the ones that do it just as a sport, not necessarily to like hunt fish or anything as far as fishing, nothing like that. It's mainly along the lines of just of enjoying it, and it's a great workout as well, because I'll quote Brian Thompson, who is one of those cult actors. He swims a lot and he does a lot of surfing too. It's great on the body when it comes to a great workout, because essentially it works out the entire body. Like, why do you think, in fact, that a lot of the major Olympics out there, the people that are in there, part of their workout routine ensures that they do it in the water. So in this case, he was a lifelong swimmer. He was known, in fact, as a skin diver, which was another version or word of a scuba diver, and that was his main passion. But yes, they went there, and sometime around noon, that's when they decided to go to that specific spot. So lo and behold, a little bit later afterward, the group finally got to the waters, and then there Holt went into the waters. He stated that he was just going to go swimming. They, as a group, apparently saw him go out further and further. Now, at this point, they were already a little worried, because the surf there was considered high and fierce, not necessarily like to ban or to prevent swimming outright, but essentially it's a situation where you wanted to be more cautious. But in this, but they wanted to go ahead and, you know, allow him to do so, and they knew that he was experienced, along these lines. So he decided to do it, and then they saw him. You could imagine the scenario. Like, this is how I was picturing it as I was reading the information. Like, imagine him. They see him going off further and further into the coast. So, and then going out, and eventually you get to that point where you kind of start seeing the body go in and out only because it's a little bit further away, and then the waves start taking over the view of the body. So imagine something along those lines, and then finally, at that final set of moments, you see the sea take over the body, and then you don't see the body anymore. That's essentially what happened here. They saw him disappear essentially from their view. So how crazy is that? It has to be something where your worst fear is, don't go that far away, otherwise you get in trouble. You're watching it live, and then boom, they're actually gone. Like, you don't see them anymore. So they immediately raised an alert. They were able to bring along a lot of people. A search party grew. It grew to be very big, in fact. There was police that were around. There were Navy divers. There were Air Force helicopters from Royal Australian Force there too. Army personnel came out as well. There were also a bunch of volunteers. This became actually one of the largest operations, search operations in all of Australian history. That's how big this was. So even with all these personnel, all these departments, all these vessels, everybody trying to find his body, they could not do so. He was just completely gone, almost wiped off the face of the earth. And this went on for 2 days as well to try to see if anything could be done. But finally, the government decided at that point that after a well-exhausted search, they said that they thought he was dead. So, and finally, they swore in another prime minister at that point. I'm sure that it was something that was just not out of coldness, but it's just essential when it comes to government roles, that if something happens to one major political leader, then you'll always have a successor ready to lead and ensure that there's no disruption in government services. Such was the case here. And then that was it. It basically went on afterward in terms of the government there, and then the presumption that he was dead. So, as far as the theories as to why he died, here are the three of them. I mentioned that earlier in terms of what happened to him. Number one is the idea that he took his own life. He basically committed suicide. This was also related in a documentary called Who Killed Harold Holt? And they too presumed that he was someone that decided to commit suicide. What apparently shows support for this theory is the notion that this guy, Harold Holt, had this depression shortly before his death. He was a very proud person. That brief history that I mentioned to you could see that he was someone that was always looking to elevate himself little by little throughout his career. You don't get that way without being essentially proud of yourself. But before his death, like, he was experiencing some kind of problems with his health. He had an old shoulder injury, for example, that caused him this really, really severe pain. He had to take these strong painkillers, which you can imagine also is sometimes a bad thing for people that take care of themselves a lot. Like, if you they don't like to generally use a crutch, a quote unquote crutch, in terms of taking pills or other types of painkillers. They like to do things themselves. So imagine something along those lines. And then also, he had something along the lines of problems with skin diving or scuba diving because he was experiencing difficulties as he was getting older. Remember, this was a lifelong passion for him. So imagine something like this, where all of a sudden his major hobby is the one that's causing him the most problems or the most pain. There was even an incident earlier in that year where he was there snorkeling and he had these problems. Something happened, I guess, with his equipment, or he himself was having issues. But either way, he found himself having a gasp for breath all the way up, like essentially he had to lead himself up as quickly as he could up to the surface. And when he did so, he was already blue in the face. He was vomiting seawater. He was again gasping for breath. It was a situation where I'm sure it was like a huge shock to him, because now his favorite hobby was was just something that was really bad. And then also there must have been other reasons too, supporting his depression, getting old, having other health issues, whatever is the case. And so maybe he decided to take his own life before things could get even worse. And if you're wondering, like, well, that seems like a crazy notion, you have to look no further than Robin Williams. I just talked about that in one of my other Godzilla on This Day podcast. There's a perfect example of someone who decided to take their own life before things got worse afterward, especially with his Parkinson's disease. He didn't want to go down that route and then realize that he was just going to be a shell of what he was before. He decided to take his own life beforehand. So at least that's that speculation with Harold Holt. The other notion is that he was someone that that was actually, as crazy as it sounds, a spy. He was a spy for the Republic of China, and he in turn disappeared because there was a waiting submarine there. And when that happened, that he basically went into the Chinese submarine and then disappeared afterward. Nobody believes that theory. Like, it was just presented, and then that was it. That nobody else ever laid it any credence. The final theory is more simpler. It's more on the lines that he just had problems with his shoulder. You know, the stuff that I was mentioning earlier, all those injuries, and going against advice to swim because his doctors were telling him he shouldn't be swimming so much. He was still someone that wanted to do so, not suicidal, but in the sense that he wanted to prove them wrong. And so maybe in his own hubris, maybe in his own way of trying to defy these people, he ended up costing his own life because who knows, maybe his shoulder injury became so unbearable and he was so far out to sea. You could imagine something like that too, where he's saying, I will prove them wrong, and this time I'll even go out even further, you know, show them how much I can go out there and come back and make it a success and prove them wrong. And then he found out too little too late that it was going to be a big, big problem, because of his age, his injuries, everything else that was affecting him physically, and he ended up dying on that. That's a more simpler explanation. Of the three, I think the third one makes more sense, because I don't think he would have been depressed too much to at least commit suicide. Something tells me that he didn't really go that route. And then the Chinese submarine theory is just too crazy. And then the one involving just him trying to prove somebody wrong, I think something like that would makes more sense to me. But those are at least the three theories associated with his disappearance. But that's it. That's all the information tied to Harold Holt and his mysterious disappearance. Coming up on 50 years, it is still something that remains unsolved. Also, the Australian government there, they had some weird laws back then. If someone was considered disappeared, but not because of any kind of malice or anything involving like let's say a murder or anything like that, then there was usually no more investigation done into it. Like, there were no more government inquiries, there were no more inquests, no more resources, because the idea was there was a waste of quote unquote time and money if you already know the person is dead and the circumstances all point to pretty much one specific reason for it. So for a good number of years, there were no further inquiries. Now, though, in the late 2000s or early 2000s, there was finally an investigation done of something. But unfortunately, this guy, Harold Holt's son, and Nicholas Holt, stated that it was too little too late because a lot of the people at that time, a lot of the witnesses are very old themselves now, or they are dead, and there's no new evidence that has been presented even after all these years, because why would there be? I mean, all the evidence would have been given back then, unless someone decides to finally come forward that had been quiet throughout all those decades. So that's why it still remains a big mystery to this day. So, all right, everybody, thanks again as always. Take care.